The pogo go, kill a ha ha go. Patsy go, the frisco go, the fargo. Oh, keep an okey playing, the possum on the pogo. Stick around and see the show. Go overland alive, a band of jive will blow, go pogo. I go, you go, who go, to go, Polly Voo go. From Caravan Diego, a wicko and a swago. To illy, he go, she go, we go, me go, pogo. The Tascadero, wheel of power, someplace in Mexico, Delaware, Ohio, and you don't need the Texaco. Wheel in West Virginia, with everything you see ya. Down the line, you'll see the shine from Oregon to Caroline. Inny, meeny, miny, coca, moga, pogo. The teacher mingle, sing those lingo, whistle, lingo. Smoking to Hoboken, Chenango to Chicago. It's golly, I go, 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 and go, go, pogo. Virginia, where everything is in ya. Down the line, you'll see the shine from Oregon to Carolina. Oh, yeeky, meeny, miny, coca, moga, pogo. Tisha, mingo, sing those lingo, whistle, and go. Shamokin' to Hoboken, Chenango to Chicago. It's golly, I go, 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 and go, go, pogo.
This has definitely been KPFA in Berkeley, radio disaster in Northern California. Our cigarettes stuck belligerently in our ears, we press onward for the best low-fidelity uniplex short play broadcasting. Does anyone have anything of significance to do?
So gaily bedight the gallant knight, in sunshine and in shadow, wandered afar in search of a bar that served whiskey and crumpets. There's jam in the pot, as like as not, the barmaid's hair is yellow. Bide here a while. But his soft, sad smile said he loved only black-haired strumpets. Though tambours ring, she does not sing, the raven-dressed whore a-wilting. The slow-eyed lass upon the grass, she does not scratch her pimples. O knight, ride on, if pale, if wan, your search, your horse ne'er halting. With sable-haired cannot be shared the whiskey and crumpet temples.
Thank you, thank you. And now from Vivian Caulfield Oppenheim, ruminations of a lady awakened by the approach of etc. Vivian?
Ruminations of a lady awakened by the approach of her Brobdingnagian lover to the bedchamber. Whose shoes are these? I think I know. The size alone's enough to show. Great empty boats are only meet for such a pair of blatant feet. The cobbler must be filled with fear to see a pair of shoes so queer. How can mere man e'er hope to cope with laces thick and tough as rope? With tongues as large as eagle's wings and silver-plated lacing rings, what rainbow-spangled polish sheens these toes, the size of submarines. These shoes are ugly, big, and deep, with hollow sole and instep steep. They shall not steal upon my sleep. Heels so monstrous cannot creep. Here I all a tremble lie. I love him, though I know not why. For though I take him to my bed, I've never even seen his head.
Thank you.
on his baldness, 6. After Herrick on Ben Jonson. Ah, Ben, say when my hair shall come again, never or ever, now or then. Say when, Ben, shall they not come again?
Unpremeditated denture. Linger longer and think a thought. We've never given pause to tinplate pearls. We've never, no, never had recourse to feudal sweet. And we've never, if ever, paused to eat a furry peach. Too long the sound of breaking glass, another cup is shattered. Don't take no in place of drink. Drinks all that ever mattered.
Friends in Radioland, it's time to lay aside the cares of the morning, time to ascend the stairway of inspiration, time to pass through radio's golden doors and enter the land of true romance. Yes, it's time to meet Helen Trump, a woman who has that certain something and wishes she had something certain. Let's join Helen now. Corner and up your street. We bring you face to face with Helen Trump, a woman who carries two 38s and a 45 to protect them. Today we find Helen in a fretful mood, sad, troubled, filled with indecision. Last evening, just plain Rufus, an ordinary nuclear physicist, had asked her to marry him. What should her answer be? Should she really marry this elderly man? And if she did, would she feel old age creeping up on her? Why, his idea of an exciting night was to turn up his electric blanket. And just the other night, he'd gone to a Marilyn Monroe movie and complained because the theater was cold. Even Rufus admitted that in the past year, work had seemed like a lot less fun. and fun had seemed like a lot more work. Yes, it took him all night to do what he used to do all night. Even as these disturbing thoughts were flooding through Helen's warm and wonderful mind, she sensed that Rufus had entered the room, that he was standing close to her, that she was locked in his embrace. His voice seemed weary as he said,
Helen. Oh, Helen. My adorable one, my one and only love. Oh, Helen, don't draw away from me. Don't look at me as though I were a failure. I know I haven't made a lot of money. I know I haven't won fame or success. But Helen, be kind to me. I've just lost my job as a dog catcher. I knew I was supposed to catch dogs. But at what?
And so, friends, we've come to the close of another chapter in the romance of Helen Trump. A chapter that has asked us to ponder this question. Why doesn't man ever do anything right? The gods gave man fire, and he invented the fire extinguisher. The gods gave him love, and he invented marriage. Join us again tomorrow when this program, Helen Trump, a lot of women in the best places, again asks the question, why is it that the wilder a girl gets, the easier she is to pet?
I've been trapped. Lumbered. I have been lumbered. I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D. Lumbered. But I'm never gonna get lumbered again. I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D lumbered, and I don't L-I-K-E it one small bit. I'm too young to be a father. There are lots of things I'd rather be, like working down a coal P-I-T pit, when I ought to be completely unencumbered. I've been forced to buy a ring and say amen. I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D lumbered, but I'm never gonna get lumbered again. I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D lumbered. I'm completely C-H-O-K-E-D choked. Bang! All my lovely visions. I've been forced to make decisions, which I had a quid for every fag I've smoked. When I think of all the birds with whom I've slumbered, now I'll only ever see them now and then.
At the weekend, and whenever the wife's not around.
I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D lumbered, but I'm never gonna get lumbered again. If I ever get my hands upon the idiot that wrote, into every life a little rain must fall, I shall take his book of poems and I'll stuff them up his throat. 'Cause it seems to me as though I get it all. I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D lumbered, and the idea doesn't please me very much. I was not prepared for marriage. I would catch a boat from Harwich, but I don't speak any D-U-C-H Dutch. Though I know it's true, a bachelor's days are numbered, I think I should have the choice of saying when. I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D lumbered, but I'm never gonna get lumbered again. Fella M-A-D. I am scarcely past my childhood. I still play the games of childhood. I'm still playing mums and dads, as you can see. When I think of all the chicks with whom I've lumbered, for the wedding march, I'm lumbered with a hen. I've been quite unduly, well and truly lumbered. But I'm never gonna get, never gonna get, never, never, never gonna get, never gonna get, never gonna get, never gonna get. Well, now... now for a bit of peace and quiet.
Darling.
Yes?
I'm going to have a baby. Another one.
I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D Lumbus.
So have I.
I've had just about E-N-U-F enough.
So have I.
For my little bit of pleasure, I've been punished beyond measure. If you ask me, I've been treated rather rough.
So have I.
Like a garrison that's gradually outnumbered. Or a boxer when the count is nearing 10.
Down with men.
I've been L-U-M-B-E-R-E-D Lumbus.
I've been Lumbus.
My old bones ring with walking, and I would fain lie down. Or, spring is for the birds. Out of the mattress of the earth, spring has sprung. What cracked the stone? A sprig of mirth, cry the young. Clang those ringing hoops of youth, beat drum. Age, which knows the palsied truth, is dumb. Is numb with cold, too old for all those black surprises. I lie abed, and leave me be. Leap up, go forth, seek out your prizes. Not only in the lonely tree, the sap rises.
Dish of tea, but baby, don't you sugar me, don't stir me, boy, nor try to spoon. Don't sugar me, 'cause us is through. Oh, I won't sip a lip with you, let you want a granulated lump or two. Just roll them eyes right out that door. Them saucer eyes ain't square no more. All them things, them diamond rings, them stuff you promised me were figments, Newton, sure as shooting, shooting sure as A-B. See the teapot pouts that the kettle's blue. It don't work out, that spot is true. Just boil away, boy. Don't sit and brew. Don't sugar me, 'cause I'm just through.
I ride through the desert, my throat's getting dry. Devil's whirling, not a cloud in the sky.
Desert wind and the angry sun will take my life like a lawman. to see. If I can make the mountains, it will change my destiny. Desert wind and the angry sun will take my life like a lawman's gun. Dust devils reaching for the sky, pointing out the way in which I die. Dust devils dancing in their glee, the sound of Satan's laughing mockery. I shot a man in anger, that's why I have to run. The hangman stoops is certain, so I'll gamble with the sun. My pony stumbles and he begins to tire. I'll soon be alone in this valley of fire. The judge and jury is forming in the sky, pointing dusty fingers as they sentence me to die. Desert wind and the angry sun will take my life like a lawman's gun. Dust devils, dancing for the sky, pointing out the way in which I die. Dust devils, dancing in their glee, the sound of Satan's laughing mockery. The sound of Satan's laughing mockery. The sound of Satan's laughing mockery.
And now, once again, it's time to lay aside our cares of the morning. Time to greet a new and better day with a visit from that warm and wonderful person, Helen Trump. A woman who has discovered that marriage is the occupation that pays the highest wages for unskilled labor. Around the rose bed and up your stoop, we bring you another heartwarming chapter in the romance of Helen Trump. A chapter entitled, She'd Give Him 6 Months to Live and Then They'd Get Married. Today we learn that Helen is unhappy, depressed, and miserable. She has discovered that her old and close friend, just plain Rufus, is untrue. That he is dating Tuesday, Wednesday, because she is his idea of a well-balanced girl, an empty head and a full sweater. Yes, Helen is thoroughly angry, not only angry with Rufus, but angry with herself for having misjudged Tuesday, Wednesday. She'd always thought that Tuesday had too much willpower to have a good time, but now she realizes the truth. Tuesday is a good time had by all. As for Rufus, just being with him had made Helen think of weddings. Why, only last night Helen had said yes, and this morning she'd hoped that he would ask her to marry him. No, Helen could not deny it. She loved this simple man, this ordinary nuclear physicist. He was an everyday sort of man, and what more could a woman want? Yes, in his way, Rufus was a man who had everything and was hoping to get a shot of penicillin. This morning, Helen's misery is so deep, so utterly aching, that she scarcely notices when someone opens the door, when they walk across the room, when they lock her in a warm and wonderful embrace. Suddenly, it is too late to feel anything but contentment, and she listens with something close to rapture as just plain Rufus speaks.
Helen. Oh, Helen, my beloved. Don't break the spell of this moment. Yes, I know what you're thinking. I know you hate me for going out with Tuesday, Wednesday, on Thursday. Yes, I know she's good for nothing. But Helen, she's not bad for nothing.
As the golden light of day turns to the lavender light of evening, we reach the close of still another chapter in the career of Helen Trump. A chapter that has brought us this message. Ecstasy is the feeling you feel when you feel that you are going to feel a feeling that you have never felt before. Be with us again tomorrow when this program, Helen Trump, a lot of woman, again asks the question, isn't it better to kiss and tell than to kiss and exaggerate?
On the first day of peace, time my government said to me, there won't be a World War III. On the second day of peacetime, my government said to me,
save your uniform,
and there won't be a World War III. On the third day of peacetime, my government said to me, atom bombs for peace,
save your uniform,
and there won't be a World War III. On the fourth day of peacetime, my government said to me,
build a fallout shelter,
atom bombs for peace,
save your uniform,
and there won't be a World War III. On the fifth day of peacetime, my government said to me,
we are Germany.
Sputnik's just a gimmick.
We are Germany.
Build up on a counter and a bunch of peace.
Save your uniforms.
And there won't be a World War III. On the eighth
day of peacetime, my government said to me,
and select gold water.
Don't eat tuna fish. Sputnik's just a gimmick.
We are Germany.
Build up on a counter and a bunch of peace.
Save your uniforms.
There won't be a World War III. On the ninth
day of peacetime, my government said to me,
go blockade Cuba.
Let's elect gold water.
Don't eat tuna fish.
Sputnik's just a gimmick.
We are Germany.
Build a border shelter
and a monster. Please save your uniforms.
And there won't be a World War III.
On the 10th day of peacetime, my government said to me,
go blockade Cuba.
Let's elect gold water.
Don't eat tuna fish.
Sputnik's just a gimmick.
We are Germany.
Build up on our shelter
as a monster for peace. Save your uniforms.
And there won't be a World War III.
Lord, soon be over. Too late, my brother. Too late, but never mind. Oh, my trials, Lord, soon be over.
And so, sports fans, another night sounds, another weary river has wound its way to sea. Would you sign us off, please, Jerry Bryan?
I just want to say, send your comments and gift-wrapped bombs to Night Sounds, KPFA, listener-supported radio in Northern California, Berkeley 4. Until next week, then, this is Fred Savior saying, tough darts, St. Anselm, and good night.
The Minuet by Boccherini, as arranged by Gerald Bryan. The Sinfonietta di Roma was conducted by Domenico Salvino. And now from the Minuet, we go to Studio B. And
say no starch. By George, I mean no starch.
Exploring the child's world. Child is father to the man, and as we hope for a world of men of goodwill, we must look to the conditions of the child's world to achieve it. So we search for the laws, ways and means, the sources of the capable, spontaneously whole adult. It is not strange that the world of the disturbed child throws light on childhood in general, although Father Francis Duffy, chairman of the Department of Sociology at Duquesne University, was not at first looking for this light when he started working with the disturbed child. Thank you.
seems to grow upon my eye, seems to fall into my head, seems to whisper, "Listen, Fred, the fall of birds from all our skies should come to you as no surprise, for as the lowly turtle crawls, so the bird falls. Ask no more questions, banish your fret. Too many raisons spoil the debt."
We put it to you, Castle Vuvu. If you fiddle with penknives, this only we beg. Please don't play La Mumba de Peg.
In the corner. On his shoulder is his pet monkey, Gunga, dinning in his ear.
Heard about that black possum by the name of Togo? They wouldn't let him into the Ofifenoki swamp.
A laddie meets a lassie, Cameroon through the rye.
As one boar said to another, "I won't be a apartheid to your plan. Black is the color of my true love." Molly done told me. Thank you.
afternoon, where the honeysuckles bloom, when all nature seemed at rest. 'Neath a little rustic bar, mid the perfume of the flower, a maiden sat with one she loved the best. As they sang the songs of love, from the arbor just above came a bee which lit upon the vine. As it sipped the honeydew, they both vowed they would be true. Then he whispered to her words she thought divine. You are my honey, honeysuckle. I am the bee. I'd like to sip the honey sweet from those red lips you see. I love you dearly, dearly, and I want you to love me. You are my honey, honeysuckle. I am the bee.
So beneath that sky so blue, these two lovers fond and true, with their hearts so filled with bliss, as they sat there side by side, he asked her to be his bride. She answered,
yes, and sealed it with a kiss.
For her heart had yielded soon, 'neath the honeysuckle's bloom, and through life they'd wander day by day, by day. And he vowed just like the bee, I will build a home for thee.
For thee.
And the bee then seemed to answer them and say,
and seemed to say,
you are my honey, honeysuckle. I am the bee. I'd like to sip the honey sweet from those red lips you see. I love you dearly, dearly, and I want you to love me. You are my honey, honeysuckle. I am the bee. You are my honey, honeysuckle. I am the bee.
We present another program in the series, The Spirit of the Vikings.
Here are Father Duffy and Professor Jerzak.
Thank you.
The scene is the moon. It is night, but Earth haunts the thin vapored sky, and all is amber. For 17 hours, Igor Grushenko and his gallant band of plutonium hunters have been buried alive in a 6-foot bowl of moon dust. Then, when the vodka runs out, the irrepressible Igor comes up with an idea.
First, we shove Cranston out through the airlock and close the hatch on his feet. He will be tall enough to stick his arms up through the surface of the moon dust. Second, we switch on the petcock to the moon tractor's petroleum tank, thus flooding the moon dust around us with gasoline and converting it to mud. Third, we wait for the mud to dry. Fourth, after the mud is caked all around Cranston, we give him a big push, taking advantage of the moon's light gravity, and he will shoot up through the ball, thus opening a tunnel for us in the mud crust, and we will clamber out. Well, men, what do you think?
I don't like it.
You always were a party pooper, Cranston. Why don't you like it?
For one thing, if you push me too hard, I go into orbit. After all, here on the moon, I only weigh 1/6 as much as I actually weigh, right?
Tough darts, cranny baby. Think not what the crew can do for you. Think rather what you can do for the crew.
What if the mud cakes too hard to push me out?
Then we set fire to the petroleum. The moon dust won't burn, but you will. And voila, we have our tunnel anyway.
I don't like it.
What don't you like this time?
There's not enough oxygen in the moon's atmosphere to burn.
One more word out of you, Cranston, and I'll feed you to the crew. It's been 17 hours, remember, since they've had anything but vodka.
So Cranston is shoved up through the airlock, the moon dust watered with petroleum and allowed to cake. Igor's crew are unable to push Cranston up more than a few inches until they set fire to his spacesuit. Then he rises rapidly, and the men follow through the tunnel he has made. But, oh, paradox! What should they find upon scrambling out of the moon dust bowl but a far greater, more terrifying danger than that of suffocation? More terrifying because it is unknown. Alien life.
What are they?
I don't know.
How many of them are there? I can't tell because of those weird tentacles.
It looks to me like there are three of them. They're coming this way.
What do we do?
Be casual.
Look, up there in the sky. Dare I hope?
You dare, you dare. It's Captain Stanhope Cronopius, riding his white moon rat Fang. Thank God you've come, Captain Cronopius.
God had nothing to do with it. Thank Fang. Fortunately, Fang does not see as we mere Earthmen see.
Rather, he perceives ultraviolet rays and electrical charges. Energy quotients, you know. He spotted an unusual concentration of vodka in one of the dust bowls and bolted forthwith. But you're out of the bowl. What's the trouble now?
Them!
Those three Saturnian hydrangeas? Why, they can't mean you any harm.
They're advancing on us rather menacingly.
I'll intercept them and ascertain the trouble.
Captain Canopius bounds the distance between Igor and the Saturnian hydrangeas and confers with what appears to be their principal ganglion. Then he shakes tentacles all around and returns with a smile to the band of plutonium hunters.
It's all right. No trouble. There are three of them, you see. They're looking for a fourth for sex.
La mantilla llevo los sevillanos, en la mantilla llevo la sevillana, cerrada y en la mantilla un letrero que dice, viva Sevilla, un letrero que dice, mi alma viva Sevilla. Viva Triana, viva los sevillanos, viva Triana, viva los sevillanos, y brilla y la sevillana.
This has been a production of the Radio Services of Duquesne University. Technical direction by Fred McWilliams. Your announcer has been Harold Dumais. Listen again next week for another in the series Exploring the Child's World.
And that is the end of Night Sounds, at last. Our hats are off, despite the fallout, to the following egocentric joymongers. Claire Isaacs.
And I'll be singing those Berkeley blues for you again next week. Judith Wald.
Kai Uwe von dem Sohn Gunzenhäuser.
Waldemar Wege.
Paul Rackets, bud.
One nation, under all, conceived under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice.
Marco Triganza.
And off mic.
The fabulous Jack Chambers. Fred Seiden.
Arnold Corduroy.
And...
Chuck Clemens! Chuck Clemens! Chuck Clemens!
Chuck Clemens!
Chuck Clemens!
Yay.
At long last, that's all.
KPFA operates at 94.1 megacycles with a power of 59,000 watts and is heard throughout a large area of Northern California, mainly Alviso. KPFB operates at 89.3 megacycles with a power of 150 watts. Its signal is directed to areas in the Berkeley Hills which do not receive KPFA. Our studios and offices are located at 2207 Shattuck Avenue in downtown Berkeley.
The telephone number is...
Thumbsop 677777. Thumbsop 6. Thumbsop. It is. It really is. Just dial Thumbsop, sport fans.
If you know our phone number, please let us know. I think we're ready for the sign.
And now for James Eastledon, we present Stravinsky.
Station's KPFA.
Thank you.